just for two. Though you never knew you were my reason. I've gone much too far for you now to say that I've got to throw my castle away.
Maybe to with you with the lead, you two might be overjoyed.
cause it won't be too long. So darn Betty, let me try it again. It's my last time on earth, I live the whole world of sin. I'm so glad that I know more than I knew then. Gonna keep on crying.
Hello, Playtime. Welcome. We're in the Pathhead Village Hall, and tonight we're presenting a wonderful band of some of Scotland's very, very best musicians. So please have a great time listening to the fantastic Alan Benzie Trio.
Thank you. Hi everybody. So thank you very much. This is the Alan Benzie Trio, and super excited, delighted, and happy to be here in Pathhead, the Village Hall, playing for all of you. So big thank you, of course, to Tom for inviting us over, and yeah, just really, really happy to be playing with these guys, and I hope you're enjoying the music so far. So before we play any more tunes, very quickly, I'll introduce the band. I'm sure you're familiar with these guys already, but just in case. On the bass, we have Andrew Robb. Applause in my mind. And then on drums, we've got Stephen Henderson. Hope you're applauding for them very hard at home. So that first tune we played for you was a tune of mine called Glass, back when I did tune titles that didn't really mean a whole lot. So I just called that one Glass. It was something to do with kind of light passing through various mediums like glass, something like that. Exactly. So that was that. And we're going to play another one of mine for you now, and then we'll play a few that are not by me. So this next one wrote about my favorite Japanese anime, which is called Natsume Yūjincho, which means Natsume's Book of Friends. And it's kind of, it's an interesting show. It's about a boy who can see spirits that no one else can see. And then he kind of, a lot of them are unhappy spirits that have been unable to move on. And he helps them to move on and all that. So it's kind of a funny, it's partly a bit weird, a bit strange, a bit funny, but kind of mostly very warm-hearted. And I absolutely just love it. And it's got great, great score as well. So I was really inspired by that, writing this tune. And I just called it Natsume. And just before I do that, see Mario there. Hey, Mario. And so Angie as well. And nice to see Donna as well, all the way from Mill Valley, California. Hey, Donna. Good to see you. And Lindsay Byrne as well. So yeah, thanks for watching. Hope you're enjoying it. And this is Natsume. Thank you. Thank you. That was Natsume. And if you're wondering, I suppose I should mention those two tunes. The first tune we played is off my first two album. And what do we call that? That was called Traveler's Tales. And this one we just played is off our the second trio album, which is called... It's called Little Mysteries. Remember my own album name. So if you obviously if you enjoyed that, you can check those out. So next we're going to play a few tunes. We're kind of just playing a few of my tunes today, and then we're playing some other kind of favourite tunes of mine, many of which somewhat suspiciously perhaps are all by piano players. But there you go. Piano players must write good tunes. What can I say? So this next one we're going to play for you is... by the late, great John Taylor. I believe about the town in the Lake District, which is quite nice. I've been there myself. It was pretty good. You been there?
Yeah.
What about you, Stephen? You been there? Not been? So where could it be? This is about the town of Ambleside, I believe. The tune's called simply Ambleside by John Taylor.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was Ambleside by John Taylor. I put the phone on the keyboard so I can see the comments in that. Then I'm like trying not to look at them. It's funny. But yeah, so Tom mentioning Now He Sings, Now He Sobs there, which is, that's one of my favourite records as well. Absolutely amazing. And yeah, big RIP to Chick Corea. Just still like hard to believe in it. He's gone. But yeah, well, I mean, very nice to be mentioned in the same breath as that record. Anyway, amazing album. If you haven't heard it, check it out. Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. Beautiful, beautiful album. And yeah, thanks to other people. A lot of people enjoying your drumming, Hendo. Yeah, delicate drumming, lovely wee minimalist groove. Yeah, lovely. Thank goodness. Yeah, sounded great. So nice to see other people commenting and enjoying the music. Hope you're enjoying it. On that note, if you are enjoying it, should mention that you can donate if you're enjoying it and you would like to kind of support Playtime. I mean, Playtime, first of all, amazing. Just what these guys are doing and have been doing for over 6 years now. Quite some time, and I'd absolutely lovely gig with Tom, Mario and Martin playing the music of Jerome Kern a good few years ago, and that was great. And yeah, just what they're doing is fantastic, putting on great series of music, so obviously delighted to be a part of that. So any way that you can support it is great. There will be a link on screen, maybe it's there right now, I don't know, is it there right now? Matt is on it, yeah, nice one, Matt. So you can go to that link there and you can donate however much you want. So I'll leave that up to you. I believe the suggested donation is £10, but wherever you want. If you can, and if you would like to, that would be great support. So there you go. So what we're going to play next? Oh, yeah, so we're going to play now a really beautiful tune by, if anyone watched the interview, they might have remembered that Tom and I spoke a little bit about that I speak Japanese. And I might even have done my best to speak some Japanese on that as well. So yeah, I've kind of definitely strong connection with Japan. I mentioned the anime stuff earlier. But this is a really, really beautiful tune by quite well-known pianist and composer Yuichi Sakamoto. And this is called Bibo no Aozora, which I believe means something like beautiful people's blue sky, which sounds quite nice, but it's actually a pretty sad, sad song, I think. But hope you enjoy it. This is Bibo no Aozora. Donate like the wind. What does the wind donate like? I have no idea. That's great. Alright, try not to laugh at it. Thank you. Thank you. That was Bibo no Aozora by Ryuichi Sakamoto. I just seen there Tom Bancroft listening from the new hot tub. Yes. Good stuff, Tom. Oh, John Hodgson, nice to see you too. And glad to start off your weekend as well. Donna definitely is super contemplative. How do you say it? Contemplative? Contemplative? Tune absolutely right though, Donna. Yeah. Definitely often just sit in the house and play this tune when I need a bit of peace. Very helpful for that. So, yeah, absolutely right. Listening in the hot tub, can't get any better. So true. Oh, and Sophie's here as well. Nice. Hi, Sophie. Yeah, so this is quite fun, actually. I wish I could, do this on every gig. Lovely. So that was People Know Aozora. So we're going to play one more for you in this set, and then we take a break, which I believe is about 15, 20 minutes or thereabout. I think that's right. So normally I would say, oh, you go to the bar and go to your kitchen and drink more. And buy CDs, I would say that. Yeah, but there you go, weird. So this last one we're going to play for you is, again, another tune, just favourite of mine. I didn't write it. And yes, it's by another piano player. This time it's by a Swedish piano player called Jakob Karlsson, with a Z, Karlsson. And this is a tune, I think, off the album of the same name. It's called Human Factor. So we're going to play that. Before I play that, I'll just remind you, we've got Andrew Robb on the bass. Played an absolute blinder on Ambleside for a start. And we've got Stephen Henderson on the drums, killing it as well. Yeah, so having a great time playing with these two, and hope they're enjoying it too. So we're having a good time. Hope you are too. This is the last one for this set, and this is Human Factor. Thank you.
Thank you.
about Stephen Henderson on the drums there. Applause in your homes for Stephen. And Andrew Robb on the bass. That was Human Factor. Yay. So thank you. So enjoy your break. And we'll see you in the second set. Thank you.
Hello. Hey, Natsuki. Hello.
Hey.
Hello.
How are you?
Very good. Baby. How are you?
I'm okay. Yeah. welcome to Interval Interviews number 32. Where are you in Kobe? So where is Kobe?
Kobe is very close to Osaka.
Okay.
And yeah. In this west part of the Japan, and from Tokyo, 600 kilometer probably.
Okay.
Or 700.
Yeah.
And have you been in Kobe for the whole of the pandemic?
Pretty much, yes. Because, you know, we have a small apartment in Tokyo, and in Kobe, we have a bigger apartment, which is still small, but and I have my piano here.
Okay.
So it's better to be in Kobe in Tokyo. I cannot play piano if I'm in Tokyo.
And you've been doing some concerts together online. I've seen some.
Oh.
Yeah, how has that been?
It was fun. We had good time.
Yeah.
But you know, we have my piano in small soundproof room. It's like a capsule.
Yes.
So very tiny.
Mm-hmm.
And because we are tiny enough, we are there.
Not like you.
You cannot go in, I think.
I would be too big for this room.
Yeah, but September we had two concerts in Tokyo.
Mm-hmm.
But that's it. You know, people are touring and gigging in Japan. I mean, you know, our friends, musicians. But we decided not to do. Yeah, because many of our audience don't want to come.
Yeah, they are frightened to come.
Yeah. Couldn't find the point to play in the concerts. So we are kind of waiting.
Yeah, right. Or you also lived in some of the time in other countries, didn't you? You traveled a lot before all this happened.
Last year in January and February, we were in Europe. And also we were in America.
Yeah.
Right before, you know, in America, I think California locked down at first. And we were there like a week before that lockdown.
Wow.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And do you think that, didn't you go to study in Japan, in America? Did you both study in America?
Yes.
Where did you study?
We studied in Berklee College of Music in Boston, and also New England Conservatory in Boston.
Okay.
Yeah.
And were you both there at the same time?
I went Berklee at first, then Natsuki decided to come after. So I was there before he came, yeah.
And was that because you were there or because he wanted to go to Berklee?
What?
Natsuki, did you go to Berklee because Setoko was there or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. And your music is kind of more experimental than normal Berklee music. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, we were not happy actually at Berkeley. We just, felt like we were in wrong place.
Right. New England Conservatory was better.
Much, much better for me, at least, yes.
Yeah. It's interesting though, I studied at a college in Montreal that was very bebop. And it made me go the other direction. It was like, this is not me. It made it clear to me that this wasn't my path, you know? So did you find being at Berkeley helped you to decide who you were as a musician?
When I was in Berkeley, I tried to be jazz piano player. So I wanted to play someone else.
Yes.
I wanted to play Herbie Hancock or Courier whoever famous and whoever good. Then I spent 10 years to realize that I cannot.
Yes.
Yeah. And I was not happy that, doing that kind of stuff anymore. Especially after I met Paul Blay.
Okay.
Yeah.
And what happened when you met him? He's amazing, isn't he?
Yes, he is. Well, at the New England Conservatory, because he was teaching there.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. And I studied with him. And then he told me, when I played somewhere else. And he told me, why you do that? So people don't buy your CD. They're going to buy, someone else's CD. Right. So, yeah.
And was it the same for you, Natsuki, in Berkeley?
Berkeley? Yeah, I was busy for a kitchen helper.
He worked for a Japanese restaurant.
All right, okay.
Yeah, in Boston. So I was busy for cooking.
You weren't playing the trumpet, though. You were cooking.
Yeah.
I want to try your cooking next time we meet.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he's good.
Yeah, okay. So this is very interesting, this idea of trying to be someone else and then deciding to be yourself. What was it painful, this decision? Did it feel like giving something up, or was it kind of a happy moment?
If I start talking about this kind of stuff, I'm gonna take 1 hour. but if you are an improviser, you know that it is very important to have kind of confident.
Yes.
What you have. And you have to tell your story with your, with your way, with your language. But sometimes it is not easy because you don't have any confidence. And so that was big thing for me. I didn't have any confidence before I met Paul Blay. And, Paul Blay was my idol for a long time.
Yes.
Then finally I could study with him, and he told me, just play your music. That's big thing for me.
Yes.
Can I do that? Is that okay? So I started accept myself somehow.
And how old were you at that point?
37 or 8, no, 6, 36 probably. Yeah, something like that. Yeah, I was not young, yeah.
And was it last year you were 60?
Yes, no.
The year before? 2 years ago.
2 years ago.
2 years ago. So
and
now
you released a lot of CDs.
Yes.
How many did you release?
One each month, made 12 CDs in a year.
Great. And how was it? Was it a lot of work?
No, really. Because I actually made a lot of CD. Even like last year, I made like 6 or 7, right, something like that. So it's not big different.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I like doing that kind of stuff. So.
So I need to apologize to you because we made a recording quite a long time ago, and I haven't finished it. And
not yet.
No, yeah, it's kind of complicated to explain. It's not. It's a little bit connected to the conversation, but I think it's really good. And I'm. But it's one of these projects that I keep on putting it off because of something else comes in, and then I started to feel guilty because I hadn't finished it. So then it became more complicated, and. I'm very happy to be playing with you again and talking to you, so I can apologize, and I am gonna get it done because I feel like for me it was a little bit different to what I normally do, you know, in some respects, and there's something challenging around it, but I think it's really great stuff, and so I'm committing to you on camera that I will get it finished this year, and then. Because if not, I will be a failure to myself.
Wow. What year was that? I just don't remember. What
I think it was 2014. I think it was 2014. So I would like to ask you both one final question. How did you first begin to play improvised music and jazz and improvised music? What was it that made you become that kind of musician?
Mm-hmm. So I say first, mm-hmm. That was long time ago. I think it's like 59 years ago.
Wow. You were very, very young.
Yes. I was like 3 or 4 years old. And since my sister, older sister, had a piano lesson, we had a piano in a place. And I was very little, but I was very reserved. I mean, I was not like, you know, kids who play all the time outside. I just stayed my place with my mom. And I liked playing piano, but I didn't have any, of course, chops, no piano lesson. I didn't know anything about music, but I wanted to play and I improvised.
Wow. You just did it completely naturally.
Yes. Actually, I still remember I was like, you know, kind of like dreaming kids, like, you know, just with imagination or like, you know, I still remember like some flowers in vase. In the room, I was looking at that, and I was like dreaming about the you know, color and that smell, and I just improvised with piano feeling. And I think, you know, for a long time, I lost that kind of stuff because I started studying classical music.
Okay.
And piano teacher always put music in front of me and play this music, you know, written stuff. Then I lost that kind of feeling when I got like 18 years old. I found, you know, I remembered how I had good time when I was 4 years old. Then I started looking at improvisation, how I can do that. So if I go back, I think the first time I started playing that kind of, you know, improvisation is like when I was 3 or 4 years old.
Wow. Yeah. That's amazing. And nobody taught you, you just did it yourself.
Yeah, but I think, you know, that's all kids do.
Yes, I think you're right.
Yeah. And your turn. Yeah. When you study?
I don't know. When? Maybe, I think after New England concert.
No, you told me the story.
When?
he started gigging professionally after high school in Japan.
That's not improvised, but
still improvised music.
But in code.
In course, yeah, but you know.
So did he study like classical music first, or brass band, or what? How did he start to play trumpet?
Brass band,
yeah.
And a little bit classical music. Mm-hmm. Then he found his friends, who is like 2 or 3 years older than him, took him to some cabaret where he played professionally.
Right.
And that was still in high school student, you know, in high school. And he played, and he found out, wow, we can make money with doing it. Okay.
Yeah.
But he didn't know how to improvise.
Right.
But his friend said, okay, if you see some chords here, it says C, just play do, mi, so. That's it.
Yeah.
And he started improvising. Wow. Yeah. I think that's the first time for you.
Yeah, but that was all in code.
Think you could play in codes? I don't think so. I don't think he could play in codes. I think he played totally free, crazy, insane music.
No.
And how does being Japanese affect your, does it affect your music in any way?
I think that's one of the things that, you know, being Japanese or being Scottish or English, yeah, whatever. I think we do have that kind of stuff, of course, part of it. Like, you know, I'm a woman, Japanese woman. That's part of myself. That's not all, but...
It's a layer. It's one of the layers.
Yes, yes. And Japanese, I think, you know, we are very, well, not me, but quiet, calm, I mean, stereotype.
Yes.
Reserved, quiet, calm. And, but at certain point, we get so crazy, so far out.
Yeah.
That's kind of like, you know, Japanese character, I think.
Yes.
Yeah. You know Melito Banana?
No.
You know? Okay. No? That's like punk Japanese band. Punk band.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will find them. I will look them up. Yeah. So how do you say the name?
Melito Banana.
Great. Yeah. So where's the best place for our audience to go and listen to your music before the concert next week? Do you have, where shall I send them to your website? Is that the best place to go?
YouTube.
Okay, great. Well, listen, it's really, really wonderful to speak to you again. And thank you so much. And you've said so many very interesting things just in this interview that are really cool. So both of you, thank you.
Okay.
Bye. See you next week.
Bye.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to the second set. I hope you enjoyed the interview there. I'm actually definitely want to watch that later. Sounded really interesting. Heard a couple of bits. So we're going to start the second set with a tune by... American pianist called Anthony Onesie. I keep thinking it's like onesie, like he's wearing a onesie, you know what I'm saying? But yeah, it's Onsey, Anthony Onesie. This is a really cool tune, and this is called Paradise Lost. Thank you. That was Paradise Lost by Anthony Onesie. Nice one, Stephen. Ooh, and Andrew as well. Man, these guys are killing it. Yes, great. So we're going to continue. If I could remember anything, that would be nice. Oh, yes. Okay. This is a beautiful tune by one of my favorite. I know they're all kind of my favorite piano players, but this guy is genuinely one of my all-time favorites, and I think quite an underrated pianist as well, and writes beautiful tunes. And that is another American pianist, Fred Hirsch. Beautiful player, amazing. And he wrote this really lovely tune. I think of an album inspired by the poems of Walt Whitman. It's quite cool, called Leaves of Grass. So I think this is on there. So this is called At the Close of the Day. Thank you. Thank you. That was at the close of the day by Fred Hirsch. We're going to continue now with one more tune by people that are not me. and then we're going to finish with a couple of mine. So this next one is a beautiful tune by another, again, another favourite pianist, all piano players. I gotta do some other instruments. So this is by a wonderful Polish pianist called Marcin Wasilewski. If anyone's fans of the Polish trumpet player Tomasz Stanko, that this same trio were his rhythm section for a while. And then they've got a few absolutely beautiful records of their own. Also another one with, trying to think now, they have one that just came out recently with Joe Lovano as well. So yeah, really great trio. And this tune, I believe the melody was written by Marcin's sister, Ewa Wasilewska. And then I think he maybe added some chords or some other things. I'm not exactly sure, but it's credited to both of them. So Ewa Wasilewska, Marcin Wasilewski. And this tune is called Sister Song. And nice to see people still enjoying. Thank you. Tom, sound quality in the hot tub is A++, apparently. Who needs speakers when you've got a hot tub? John Hodgson, listen to it. And all right, cool. Good that you're getting it nice and clear, John. What's your question, Andrew?
So you know how when we're playing tunes that aren't yours,
yeah,
your favourite piano player?
Yeah.
Does that mean when we play your tunes, you're also...
So Andrew's saying, right, when we play all these tunes by other people that are my favourite piano players, does that mean when we play my tunes, I'm my favourite piano player? The answer is a resounding no. But some days I feel all right. You know how it is. So yes, anyway, this tune is called Sister's Song. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was Sister Song by Eva Vasilevska and Marcin Vasilevsky. Just seen here. Thank you. It is a lovely tune. Thank you. John. Oh, John's asking for From A to B. We're not playing From A to B today, but we'll play it another time for sure. But I'm glad you like the tune so much. Actually, it's another one from the first album. I know it's weird to say about your own tune, but I quite like that tune too. But yeah, so sorry we're not playing it today, John, but definitely play it another time. And I heard Thomas Danko in Queen's Hall in 2006. I think, maybe I wasn't here for that. I would have loved to have seen that. But I saw Marcin in the Queen's Hall a while back. Yeah, it was really good. So yeah, and thank you very much. Great playing, guys. Isabel, so appreciate that. Thank you. Sorry? Saw Danko at the Barbican. Man, amazing. I saw him in Boston as well. Amazing player. So yeah, that was Sister Song. And we're going to play, I just can't remember. Oh yeah, okay, so we're going to finish off with a couple of tunes of mine. The first one, this was basically inspired by me being a bit weird, which is very common, that's what I'm like. But yeah, I kind of, a couple of times, I'm from the south side of Glasgow, but I was over for various things in the West End a few times, and a few times, yeah. No, I live there now, but this was ages ago. I'm from the south side, okay? South side. But yeah, so I live in the West End now, which is funny, I suppose. But at that time, I didn't know it at all. And at the end of what I was doing over there, I think I had some rehearsals and stuff like that. I came out more than once and just a beautiful, glorious sunset, the West End. And I've got this weird thing where I know sunsets are a bit of a cliche, but I love them. And I want to get the very last, you know, like you've got like a bottle of juice or something, you like want the last bit or something, you know what I'm saying? Something like that, right? Just want that last bit of sunset. I don't know. So I kind of would, you know, buildings getting in the way as the sun was going down. I was like, oh, I just want that last bit of sun, try to chase it around the West End and all that. And then just finding myself in the dark, completely lost in the West End. It was really stupid. And the most stupid thing is I did this more than once. You'd think like after the first time I'd learn my lesson, but apparently not. Anyway, so I said, I got to stop doing this. It's really stupid. So I said, look, will there be another one? Will there be another one? Maybe. Right, it's Scotland, so you never know. But like, you know, will we see the sun again? Probably. Will there be a sunset again? It's relatively likely within the realms of probability. It's pretty up there to happen again. So I thought, right, you got to let that go. When you see a nice one, sunset, whatever, just let it go. That's all right. And then I thought, yeah, it's also true in life. Sometimes, you know, good things are impermanent. Got to let them go. And so things will be okay. That's fine. So that was kind of the feeling that I wrote this tune with. Let things go. Things are going to be cool. That's the basic vibe there. So yeah, so it's called There Will Be Other Sunsets. And thank you for putting up with me rambling for ages about that. But there you go. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So that was There Will Be Other Sunsets, written by me being unable to let sunset go and stay in sensible places. So we've come to our last tune for tonight. Before we play that, first of all, I want to say a big thank you to Tom Bancroft. Woo! And Playtime, thanks so much for having us. Yeah, when Tom sent messages, I was just like, yeah, excited to come and play. So I really appreciate you having us, and Tom for looking after us today and just generally being brilliant. So thank you very much to you. And Playtime in general, absolutely just great. As I said before, great series, great stuff. So big love to all the Playtime family. Want to say a big thank you to Matt, who's been doing the sound and the lights and the haze and everything for us. Matt, there've been loads of stuff in the comments saying, Matt, fantastic. So great, and we agree, really appreciate it. So thank you. And of course, I want to say thank you to Andrew Robb on the double bass. Applause in my mind. And Stephen Henderson on the drums. I'm sure you'll all agree they've played brilliant, and it's been just so much fun. Yeah, it's still opportunities few and far between to play together like this, so it's just fantastic and really appreciate it. And of course, thank you to all of you that have tuned in and watched and sent nice comments and stuff. It's very heartening, I have to say. Wish I could have nice comments like that throughout my gigs in general, just like feel nice. But no, we really, really appreciate it, so thank you to all of you. And one last quick reminder, I think I should say, you can donate. I'm sure you guys have seen the link already, but the link will be hovering around somewhere, so if you want to go and do that, there is still time. You can still make it. And of course, if anyone has already, thank you very much. So this is going to be our last tune. Once again, thank you so much. And we're going to play what I, with just a hint of irony, like to call Alan Benzie Trio's greatest hit. And it's either that or From A to B, actually. I'm not sure. But so this one, I'll try not to ramble on too much. I've spoken enough already. But I basically wrote it after a dream I had about some frogs. So if you want to know more about that, you can send me a message or something. But yeah, so this one is called Frog Town on the Hill. So thanks once again. Really hope you've enjoyed yourself. And really looking forward to the rest of the series as well. It's going to be just so many great things. So do check all of those out as well. And yeah, thanks very much. Here we go. Thank you, Andrew Robb, Stephen Henderson.
Hello, Benzie.
Hello, Benzie. Thank you very much once again. Thank you so much to Tom, Playtime, Matt. Everybody, thank you so much. Thank you all for watching, and have a good night and weekend and all that. And hopefully see you for real in person sometime. Thank you.